All right. Tracey Neville is with us this morning. How are you? You're very welcome.
Hi, thank you for inviting me on.
You're here for a sports coaching conference.
Yeah, with Liberty Pro Insurance, in respect to, looking at the research around how we can get more females into coaching.
What do you think?
I think it's a real challenge for females. I'm actually fortunate to come from a sport where I actually have role models within netball, where I'm constantly growing up seeing, coaches flourish, and my icons and ambassadors within that are, Lisa Alexander, Jill McIntosh. I think other sports really face that challenge, particularly when there's a male equivalent. And I feel that there's a lot of barriers of women actually breaking into sports where there is a male and female equivalent.
Yeah, I mean, so was netball always your sport as a kid?
No, actually, I played a diverse sport. I actually started out in football, and I was probably guided away from football because women's football wasn't very strong then, and they deemed it as a male sport. So I remember at school saying that they wouldn't mix the genders, and obviously they wouldn't let me play football. But I obviously played from a wide diverse. I played hockey, did athletics, did rounders. So yeah, I come from a diverse that, but I obviously specialised as I got older.
Yeah, because that seems like it's interesting. That's the first thing you talked about, was that there's a male and female sport. But netball didn't have that, right?
Like, yeah.
So it's easy to find a pathway, but there's a kind of competition and the constant comparison that's going on by the naysayers, essentially, right? Going, oh, this isn't as good as this other sport here. Why is the sport not the same as this? That's one of the barriers that women's sports always have, right?
Yeah, definitely. And I always say, we talk a lot about women's sport, and at the end of the day, it is just sport. And I think when you're employing someone for a job, you're employing them for their skill set, their expertise, particularly my roles, the leadership, the business management, and there's a lot in encompass this actual particular role. So actually looking at specific gender is not the way forward. However, I do feel that females have a lot of barriers in respect to, how do we migrate them into it? My mum got coaching because it was by accident. Have we got a support program where...
What did she get it in? Sorry, what
was... Just by accident. So basically, I was taking a netball team. My coach stopped. She used to watch every week and she ended up taking my
taking
team
netball,
on.
Even though, was that
yeah,
her sport?
But it was something that she lacked confidence in doing because it was something that she hadn't had any experience of. And I think there is a way that we could migrate females into the sporting world through great support programs, putting a little bit of financial support around it, giving them the confidence and self-belief. Because I remember when I stepped into this role for the first time and into coaching, I lacked a little bit of confidence. You know, what would the players think of me? I questioned my coaching, I questioned the ability to go out and, give my true character. And that was actually, I was actually supported by someone, one of my great friends in coaching, but people are just not as fortunate as me.
How big is the financial aspect when you talk about financial supports? Because we had Casey Stoney in with us a couple of months ago talking about the idea that you kind of actually need to have a bit of money to do your coaching badges. And ultimately, footballers in the women's game aren't earning enough to actually justify that in a lot of cases, whereas the men have plenty of money to actually go and get their coaching badges done. Is that the same in all sports in your view, or is that really just an exclusive football problem?
No, it's definitely support. I was actually fortunate again to have mine supported by a governing body, but to be able for me to do that, I had to give back to the region to be able to, for them to fund my sport. And basically, I had to put the money up front and I had to complete my sporting badge before they actually financially supported that. So I was quite fortunate to be able to do that. However, people are lacking time. So these coaches that are coming through the coaching clubs, they're also working full time in employment as well. They also have families. So there's a lot of barriers around that. And I think the ideal model would be for them to actually be supported within their own environment. But there just isn't the mentoring or the financial support for the governing bodies to be able to action that, particularly in netball as well. We work off a very limited budget.
Like, I know it'd be keen to actually talk about netball here, but just sorry to talk about football again for a moment.
Yeah.
Like, how far are we actually from a place where it's just going to be commonplace for women to be coaching men?
I think we're a little bit off that. However, I've seen the way netball's moved in the last 2 years just because some of our success. At the big end of the game in the Premier League, I'm obviously being joined by Emma Hayes later, and it will be interesting to see what her comparison is about. There's been talk around her taking over the Chelsea management role because she's doing so well in the women's equivalent. But I do think there's a lot of stigma around women taking the men's game. You've seen it in the refereeing society in women's football. You've seen the women referees have not been able to come through the system as smoothly, and there's a lot of angst against them, particularly when they make decisions on the pitch and that. I don't think there's particularly good role models through the system to be able to do that. And I don't think it can stop at the top level. I don't think it can start there. I think they have to change the system from the pathway. They have to hit the pathway first. So actually it becomes quite natural to be coached by a woman. It becomes quite natural to be refereed by a woman. I think that's where we have to start putting female coaching in.
How do you change the pathways?
I think the pathways are very easy to change because they're actually run a lot by the governing bodies. So I actually think the governing bodies need to take a little bit more action in respect to how they can put a mentoring programme on to be able to start increasing coaching mentoring around both genders. And I don't think enough is being done through that.
So basically support women earlier in their coaching careers.
I think it has to be supported through grassroots because not every coach is going to make it, and that's just an absolute unrealistic expectation. However, you know, I went out to netball on Sunday to watch my little niece, and they were being coached by a dad's netball. They were being coached by dads, and that was really nice to see. It's really refreshing. I go out to my nephew's football. It's very rarely I see a female coaching at the grassroots level, and why can't that happen? Because we're a skill set. And a lot of women have the great attributes of a skill set to be able to take a team at any level.
And notwithstanding, just to go back to what you said, even when you got your job, you still, despite all of your amazing experience and career and qualifications, you still had that, was it a lack of confidence, you said, or just a doubt at the start? Am I right for this?
Yeah, definitely. When I come into this job, I was supported by Waitomai, who's one of a guru of netball, and I actually asked my governing body, my PD, to actually fly her over and watch me in the setting and, you know, direct my coaching, mentor me. You know, a lot of the things that she actually pulled out from me was that I'd lost a little bit of my personality. I'm quite a chatty, laughable, and I'd lost a lot of my personality because I was coaching at such a high level. I felt that my personality and the person I was had to change, and that wasn't actually the case. And I think that's where you lack a little bit of confidence. You don't want to, you know, step over the mark, but you also have to bring a little bit of yourself and vulnerability to the job as well, because that makes you a person.
Yeah.
And coaching is all about people and getting a team together. And I think that's something that she really instilled in me, that never lose your character and the person that you are. And I think that is some of the stigmas and lack of belief and confidence that a lot of women face.
At grassroots level, you can see why that would also, like the under sixes or the under eights or the under tens for the football or whatever, or for rugby, whatever the sport is, that it's hard because, like, everybody probably feels that. Like, you don't, unless you've been in a coaching course, you're not really qualified to coach kids' teams. All you're trying to do is to get them in that first period when you're starting out as a coach yourself, is do some drills, play a game at the end, don't kill each other, let everybody come back next week and we'll have a good time.
And I think, I think it's all about, you know, when I started out coaching, I didn't coach at the top level, and I think that's some of the mistakes that coaches make. I think what you do is you go into an environment where you make mistakes, you know, you're not perfect, you make some mistakes, you learn by them, but actually what you're not doing is you're not being hounded by press, by fans. But I think there's a real stigma around that actually you also have a massive cohort of influencers, which is the parents, the people who stood on the sideline. You make a mistake, and then they're at you, and then you lack confidence. If you lose, who are the first people that come at? Your parents. And I think they're probably the worst critics of all the things, and I think that needs to change. And about how you do that, I go out to my niece's netball now, they don't even let the parents watch, and that's a real cruel for someone like my mum, who's followed me all my life. But however, this, you know, what they're creating is an environment that actually is not comfortable for coaches to flourish.
Yeah, no, for sure. Are you in favour of splitting genders, or what age should genders be split playing sport?
I do think in actual the playing sense or in coaching?
In playing sense.
I do think that men have physical attributes that don't marry. I personally wouldn't want men involved in netball, although there is mixed netball at the participation level, and I think that's a real great sport. But I personally wouldn't want males involved in netball and a mixed team at a national level in my job. And the reason for that is they have different physical characteristics. I do believe that we are a female-driven sport, and I'm really strong on that. Actually, we have a sport that's aesthetically pleasing, that, you know, it is gender specific. I do believe there should be a male equivalent. However, in the UK at the moment, we haven't got the funding for that. So I'm actually quite happy for there not to be share my funding. But, you know, I do think there's
kids growing up, though, like it.
Yeah, I do think the mix. I played with my brothers all the way through my youth. You know, I played cricket, I played football, I did everything. I went in the goal, I did everything like that. I think there should be a mix of abilities through. I do think there is a separation as, obviously, maturation happens. I do think there should be a separation.
Yeah, but not until 12 or 14.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't separate. I still do stuff with my brothers now. Probably not the physical sense because we're not in good shape as we used to be. But, you know, I think there's characteristics of my brothers that have really supported me from that. The male characteristics have really supported me through my playing and my coaching career.
How much do you think a mix of sports helped you reach a high-level performance? Same with your brothers as well, having played cricket and all that. Is the cross-pollination of sports and actually just applying different skills, does that help you reach a higher skill level?
Yeah, we did a lot of research in... We did a coaching thing on a lot of research in that, and it isn't... It's the research suggests that you obviously should either play a lot of sports, or if you look at some of the best Brazilian footballers or the Argentinian, they play football, but they play it in very different ways. They play it on the streets, they play it competitively, they play it one-on-one, they play all different variations of the sport. And I'm a great believer in that, you know, one of the angst that I have as a coach is if my players are not playing, that causes me problems. Because actually, what do you get into sport by playing. So we try and create environments, and it becomes probably a little bit more elitist as you get older. But at the bottom level, go and play local league, go and play on outside, go and play in your school, go and play one-on-one, go and play different sports, because that is an absolute attribute to success. However, not everyone's going to make it. But what it'll do is it'll increase your skill set.
You're thinking about the same sport in a different way constantly, and I guess it is the kind of wide spectrum of your thinking that helps you reach a high level.
Yeah, because there's different parts of the game that you can actually exemplify. You know, you know now in the UK we play for netball, we play a high five, we play a seven-a-side, we play little two-on-two games. You know, there's different ways that you can actually work the sport to actually bring out a skill set that you need, like either a possession, a space run, a one-on-one. You know, there's different attributes that you can play the game, and game sense is absolutely crucial to being able to push on in a sport.
Does netball suffer from constant comparisons with basketball?
It actually doesn't in the UK, because I would probably say in the UK netball is probably a bigger supported sport than basketball. However, one of the challenges we get is we can't get into the Olympics because we haven't got a male equivalent. And also probably some of the big countries like America and in Europe, they actually don't play netball. So it's not seen as a strong sport or a hard sport. So that, you know, is a massive barrier for us getting in the Olympics.
What was it that got you into it in the first place?
My mum. And you talk about female ambassadors, you know, even my mum now, she plays three times a week. She's the only member of our family who can actually go out there and still play and has a body that's actually able to do that. But, you know, my mum, you know, you follow your mum out to a sporting event, you pick up a spare bib, you help out. And that's exactly how my nieces are doing now. They go and watch my mum play. They pick up a spare bib, they come to me and we do some netball stuff. And, you know, you think about how the growth of sport and the growth of mindset of children these days, and they need role models, and a lot of it starts at home and within their family environments. And, you know, we have a massive project in netball about back to netball, and I see so many mums now going back to netball to play. That, you know, it's something where they can go, they can make friends, they can get some activity. The sport actually complements every single person. We have a goal shooter who plays in restricted. We have a centre who likes to run around. So, and they take the daughters along with them and they play on comparative courts. So I think that is the way we need to start taking grassroots forward.
That is the most important part, isn't it? Is to get adults to come and then to be nice when they're there. It's a good combination to inspire them.
I do think a sideline is quite a challenging. Even I look at now, my sideline's just got bigger. And I think they're the biggest critics. And you think, actually, if a positive role models were being generated from that, would that then create a more comfortable environment for people to take risks, you know, put their best foot forward and maybe jump in the water rather than just dip their feet in?
Yeah. All right. So you're at the Women in Sport, the Coaching Effect Symposium, taking place today, courtesy of Liberty Insurance. And if anybody wants to do any more writing, or any more reading on this, have you got any good sources for people to?
I Googled a lot of it, and there's a really great New Zealand article, New Zealand did something on their sport about getting people into female coaching into sport. It was the New Zealand Herald. They did a really good research article on that, and I think that was quite inspirational. And also Female Coaching UK, they've done some really good articles on this as well.
Okay, so there's research which will be published today from Liberty Insurance, which is worth digging out, and also Googling as well. Tracey, thanks very much for joining us this morning.